Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Dead Sea Scrolls, A Very Short Introduction, Second Edition, by Timothy Lim, narrated by Malcolm Hillgartner. Chapter 1. The Dead Sea Scrolls as Cultural Icon. The year 2017 marks the 70th anniversary of the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Many people have heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls, but few know what they are or the significance they have for our understanding of the Old Testament or Hebrew Bible, ancient Judaism, and the origins of Christianity. Since their discovery in 1947, and especially from 1991, when all the remaining unedited scrolls were released to the world at large, there has been a surge of publications ranging from the popular to the technical. The technical works are inaccessible to most people apart from specialists, and the popular print copies and ebooks vary in quality, from the sensational blockbusters, often involving a Vatican conspiracy theory, to the sound and reliable. In this very short introduction to the Dead Sea Scrolls, I will discuss the discovery, the controversies and personalities involved in the scholarly debates, the legal actions, the politics, and the vested religious interests. Moreover, I will introduce traditional and specialist studies of Jewish history and thought between 200 BCE and 70 CE. The archaeology of the Khirbet Qumran, the area where the scrolls were discovered, paleography, study of old handwriting, textual criticism, philology, linguistics, and ancient biblical exegeses. There will also be a discussion of the most recent technological advances, often neglected by introductory textbooks. In keeping with the aims of this series, the treatment of each topic will necessarily be brief and selective. The intention is to whet your appetite and to pique your interest, rather than to provide a comprehensive introduction to the Dead Sea Scrolls. A newspaper headline in The Independent on 12 November 2004 read, "Afghanistan wants its Dead Sea Scrolls of Buddhism back from UK." The article written by Nick Mayo reported that Dr. Saeed Ranin, the Minister for Culture and Information of Afghanistan, was attempting to restore the collection of the Kabul Museum and would be formally requesting the return of the Kharoshti scrolls from the British government. The Kabul Museum had been ransacked during the war that ousted the Taliban government, and the collection of 60 fragments of scrolls, written on birch bark and in the ancient script of Kharoshti, disappeared into the antiquities market before resurfacing at the British Library in 1994. On 26 July 2006, the BBC covered a story of the discovery of the Book of Psalms in Latin in a bog at Fatton Moor in North Tipperary with the headline, "Irish Dead Sea Scrolls in Bog." This 8th-century Irish psalter was serendipitously found by the driver of a digger extracting peat with a mechanical hoe, and originally contained all 150 psalms of the traditional Book of Psalms. It is written on 60 pages of vellum, and hailed as the most spectacular find of manuscripts of the Middle Ages for several centuries. The book was restored, and in May 2014 was put on display at the National Museum of Ireland. IrishCentral.com reported that Dr. Patrick Wallace, the museum director, described the accidental find of the book to be more important for Ireland than the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Notable is the way the newspaper headlines, journalists, directors, and curators of museums and libraries used the Dead Sea Scrolls to signify a collection of ancient manuscript finds. The Kharoshti texts are Buddhist scrolls dating to the 1st century CE and have no historical connection to Judaism. They are significant for the study of the early development of Buddhism and the search for the historical Buddha. The comparison, suggested by the staff of the British Library, was intended to underscore their great antiquity and importance. The Fatton Moor Psalter may be a book of Psalms, but it attests to early Christian tradition and book production in Ireland rather than the transmission of the biblical text in early Judaism. The peculiar usage of the name is evidence that the Dead Sea Scrolls have taken on a symbolic status. They are no longer just the scrolls of a Jewish sect that lived by the Dead Sea, but represent any important discovery of ancient manuscripts. In transcending, so to speak, the historical context of Second Temple Judaism, 515 BCE to 70 CE, the Dead Sea Scrolls have become a cultural icon. Popular fiction, such as the bestseller The Da Vinci Code by Dan Brown, includes references to them in order to add intrigue and mystery to the story. Or again, in an earlier novel called The Mandelbaum Gate, published in 1965 by Muriel Spark, the well-known author of The Prime of Miss Jean Brody, the fiancé of the main character works as an archaeologist excavating Khirbet Qumran. How did the scrolls become so popular? The media and the scrolls. The reasons for the popularity of the Dead Sea Scrolls are not difficult to discern. From their initial discovery by two Bedouin shepherds in 1947 to the battle for the scrolls in the late 1980s and early 1990s, the media have always been involved in reporting the finds, the politics, the personalities, and the academic squabbles to an interested public. Some of the reporting trades on sensationalism, with or without the backing of one or more academics. Other reports offer sound coverage of the latest developments in scrolls research. And there is, moreover, a whole range of other types of publicity between these poles. In any case, the involvement of the media, newspapers, television, and radio, have ensured that the public, especially in the United Kingdom, United States, Canada, and Australia, would have read or heard about the Dead Sea Scrolls. One of the events that garnered considerable press coverage was the so-called Battle for the Scrolls. Essentially, the conflict was drawn between a small group of scholars who had in their possession unpublished material from the largest depository of the 11 caves of Qumran, Cave 4, and others who wanted and demanded access to them for research and study. The tension between the haves and have-nots had been building up for several years, but it came to a head in the summer and autumn of 1991. On 29 October 1991, after much bad blood had been spilled, the battle was won by the advocates of free access when it was announced by the Israel Antiquities Authority that a new policy of access was being implemented. An article reported in the Times heralded the news with this headline: Israel opens access to the Dead Sea Scrolls. Within weeks of the announcement of the new policy, two American scholars, Michael Wise, then of the University of Chicago, and Robert Eisenman, formerly of California State University at Long Beach, announced to the world the discovery among the hitherto unpublished scrolls of a small fragment that allegedly attests to a slain or pierced Messiah. A seminar in Oxford was organized that examined the six-line text, concluding that, quite to the contrary, the fragment does not speak of a Messiah who is slain, but rather an anointed prince of the congregation who puts his enemy to death. These diverging interpretations will be discussed in Chapter 11 on the relationship between the scrolls and early Christianity. The seminar was covered by a journalist, Oliver Gilley, and his article appeared on the front and inside page of The Independent, published on 27 December 1991. One of the features of the seminar that was highlighted in the subsequent reporting was the use of computer technology and imaging software to enhance the Hebrew script. The imaging equipment was available at Yarnton of the Oxford Center for Hebrew and Jewish Studies as part of the Qumran project, funded by an anonymous donor, and under the guidance of Alan Crown, formerly of the University of Sydney. I had produced an enlarged and enhanced image of what turned out to be fragment 5, now renumbered as 7, of 4Q285, 4 meaning cave 4, Q meaning Qumran, and 285 meaning the number assigned to the scroll, which was subsequently published in the Journal of Jewish Studies. This was one of the first applications of imaging software to the study of the scrolls. Several aspects of the battle for the scrolls are noteworthy. First, the date of the publication of the newspaper article coincided with the Christmas season. This was reasonable since the Oxford seminar was convened on 20 December. Over the years, however, I have noticed that the pattern of media reports and broadcasts, in the broadsheets, on the radio or television, almost always follows Christmas or Easter. Of course, this should not be surprising, since the scrolls are religious documents and are of particular interest during the annual cycle of festivals, but it is the Christian and not Jewish holy days that are followed. The fact that the movable feast of Easter is based upon the date of the Passover does not detract from the point that the media have in their sights the Christian rather than the Jewish religious cycle. Why not publish reports to correspond to the Jewish New Year or Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement, for instance, since almost all scholars believe that the scrolls are Jewish and not Christian? The reason is that it is the connection to Christianity that makes the scrolls sensational. If, for instance, a slain Messiah could be found in one of the Dead Sea Scrolls, then some have argued that it would call into question the uniqueness of Jesus and the foundations of the Christian faith. As an aside, this type of argument, baldly stated as it often is in the media, depends upon a rather simplistic understanding of Jesus and the Christian faith in supposing that the discovery of an archaeological artifact would undermine Christianity in this way. Within Jewish history, Jesus was not the only person to have been considered a Messiah, even a suffering one, by his followers. Regardless, it could be argued that a slain Messiah figure in the scrolls would not question the uniqueness of Christ, but would rather underscore the view increasingly accepted by Christians in the post-Holocaust interfaith dialogue that Jesus was a Jew and not a Christian. Second, the application of modern technology to the study of ancient manuscripts has its own inherent fascination. The contrast between the very old manuscripts and cutting-edge electronic tools. With the explosion of computer applications and web technology, there are now impressive internet sites. For instance, the Orion Center for the Study of the Dead Sea Scrolls and Associated Literature, orion.mscc.huji.ac.il/, of the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, will allow a surfer to take a virtual visit of Khirbet Qumran, join an ongoing discussion group, and search the bibliographical database. Computer technology is used in an increasing number of applications for scrolls research and the dissemination of information. In 1997, I edited the Dead Sea Scrolls Electronic Reference Library, a CD-ROM database that would allow scholars to search for images of specific scrolls, enhance, and print them out for personal study. This was followed by Volume 2, produced by the Foundation for Ancient Research and Mormon Studies, Brigham Young University, with a database edited by Emmanuel Tov, including a searchable transcription and translation of all the non-biblical scrolls. Today, several of the electronic Bible study tools include one or more modules of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Other notable developments and projects in the United States include the enhancing and reduction of background noise of a text called Genesis Apocryphon by Gregory H. Behrman, a scientist of the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, who specializes in analyzing satellite images. Behrman developed a technique called multispectral imaging to produce readings, for instance, the Book of Noah, invisible to the human eye from the badly deteriorated script. The Dead Sea Scrolls are now accessible on the internet, produced with advanced digital technology. Google and the Israel Museum in Jerusalem have mounted on their website digitized images of five of the best-preserved scrolls, the Great Isaiah Scroll, the War Scroll, the Commentary on the Habakkuk Scroll, the Temple Scroll, and the Community Rule Scroll. These images are so good that scholars find them suitable for use in research. dss.collections.imj.org.il. There is a scrolling and zoom function for each image, numbered according to column. Additionally, the Great Isaiah Scroll has an accompanying English translation that pops up when the cursor is hovering over a verse, and the image can be digitally manipulated to look like an actual scroll being rolled and unrolled. The other scrolls and fragments are being digitized and made available at the Leon Levy Dead Sea Scrolls Digital Library by the Israel Antiquities Authority. deadseascrolls.org.il/locale=EN_US. Access to the K4 scrolls and the reading of a putative slain Messiah fragment are two of the controversies. There have been others in the eventful past 70 years. For instance, John Allegro, a British scholar at the University of Manchester, led expeditions to the Judean desert to hunt for the treasures mentioned in the Copper Scroll. This scroll from Cave 3 is unique among the Dead Sea Scrolls in using copper as its writing material. All the other scrolls were written on skin or papyrus. The text, etched on copper plates, describes 64 hiding places of gold, silver, temple sacrifices, and another copy of the same scroll in the Judean desert. These treasures are what Allegro set out to find. Other scholars interpret the treasures, amounting to some 65 tons of silver and 25 tons of gold, as literary fiction, and liken the copper scroll to the text Mesechet Kelim, Tractate of the Temple Vessels, a medieval text that described how the treasures of the Solomonic Temple were sequestered to a tower in Baghdad and their hiding places recorded on a copper tablet. Allegro failed to turn up any treasure, but his expeditions were widely reported in the media. Tourism and the Dead Sea Scrolls. Another reason for the popularity of the Dead Sea Scrolls is tourism. Every year, thousands of tourists and pilgrims descend on Israel, visiting places holy to Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Among them, the archaeological site of Khirbet Qumran in the Judean desert and the Shrine of the Book of the Israel Museum figure high on the list of places to visit. At Khirbet Qumran, they are led by informed guides around the archaeological site and are given a viewing of the nearby caves. The number of tourists who visit each year is impressive. Interested consumers can purchase facsimiles of scrolls and the jars in which some of the manuscripts were stored, as well as a whole range of souvenirs, including Dead Sea Scrolls pens, t-shirts, ties, scarves, and mud. For those who prefer their visit at the click of the button, there is now a virtual three-dimensional immersive virtual tour of the archaeological site. 3disrael.com/dead_c/Qumran.cfm. Social media host numerous pages devoted to the Dead Sea Scrolls, where the public would be able to follow the latest developments in research. Politics and the Dead Sea Scrolls. The Dead Sea Scrolls are regarded as a cultural icon in Israel. On 20 to 25 July 1997, scholars from around the world were invited to Jerusalem to mark the Jubilee celebration of the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Among the many events of this occasion was the memorable opening of the proceedings by the then Prime Minister of Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu, the former mayors of Jerusalem, Teddy Kollek and Ehud Olmert, and James Snyder, the director of the Israel Museum. Sitting outdoors on the grounds of the Israel Museum and in the dimming light of a Jerusalem evening, I, along with Christian, Jewish, and other scholars from Israel and abroad, heard of how the scrolls were politically significant to the state of Israel. The year of the discovery of the scrolls, 1947, coincided with the re-establishment of the Jewish state after some 2,000 years. The scrolls, we were told, played a symbolic role in the return of the Jewish people to their origins, and this point was underscored by the setting of the ceremony. It was a marvelous celebration, and there was even a specially commissioned musical composition by Michael Wolpe, whose libretto is based upon texts from the scrolls. The Shrine of the Book, a specially constructed underground museum built to display the Dead Sea Scrolls, has an above-ground structure that was built to resemble the lid of an ancient jar in which some of the scrolls were kept. We were seated in front of it, and in the background was Israel's parliament, the Knesset. The political capital made out of the Dead Sea Scrolls by Israel's leading politicians was not lost on us, but a dignified silence was maintained. It was only when it was mentioned that the Dead Sea Scrolls were vital for Jerusalem did a disapproving titter ripple through the audience, This was amusing to those assembled, since most experts believe that the Dead Sea Scrolls belong to a pious Jewish group of Essenes who, among other things, held that the Jerusalem priesthood was corrupt, and as a result separated themselves from the majority of the people and went into a self-imposed exile in the Judean desert. When the scrolls were first discovered in 1947, Khirbet Qumran, the caves associated with it, and the Judean desert were under the authority of the British Mandate and the Antiquities Ordinance of 1929. With the political changes after 1948, almost all of the scrolls fell into Israeli hands. Most are kept at the Shrine of the Book and the Rockefeller Museum in East Jerusalem. The Copper Scroll is an exception and still finds its home in the Department of Antiquities in Amman, Jordan. There are also a few fragments in the Bibliothèque Nationale de Paris and scattered in private collections throughout the world. There is even one stamp-sized fragment, the so-called McGill fragment, in Canada. Ownership of antiquities in general is a much-disputed issue that carries a complex set of political and legal considerations. Using the legal principles of succession and territorial link, Wojciech Kowalski has argued that the fact that the scrolls are currently stored in Israel is in full harmony with international standards of the protection of cultural property. Not everyone will agree with this view. Legal considerations of ownership aside, there is little doubt that the scrolls belong first and foremost to the Jewish people before they are humankind's common heritage. In the United Kingdom, the political association was explicit in the 1998 Scrolls from the Dead Sea exhibition at the Kelvin Grove Art Gallery and Museum in Glasgow. The Israel Antiquities Authority had decided to allow an exhibit of the Dead Sea Scrolls to be set up in Glasgow as recognition of the Jewish community there and in celebration of the 50th anniversary of the founding of the State of Israel. The Jubilee exhibition was the only one to be held in Britain, and it attracted hundreds of thousands of people. The Vatican and the Dead Sea Scrolls. A conspiracy theory involving the Vatican has long been attached to the publication of the scrolls. It is unclear who originally came up with the conspiracy theory, but John Allegro was certainly one of the first to have expressed it. According to him, the original team of international interdenominational scholars had access to all the scrolls, and the publication of the manuscripts was progressing apace in the early 1950s. By the late 1950s, however, John Allegro was beginning to suspect a Catholic monopoly and even conspiracy. Certain members of the editorial team were being assigned more and more of the manuscripts. Joseph Millick, Gene Starkey, and John Strugnell, all Catholics, were given the lion's share. Allegro had remarked to a friend, "I am convinced that if something does turn up which affects the Roman Catholic dogma, the world will never see it." This suspicion has two notable features. First was his exclusion from access to the remaining unpublished scrolls. Even though he was one of the original editors, by the late 1950s, Allegro felt debarred from the team. In a letter he wrote to Frank Cross, another original editorial team member, on 5 August 1956, Allegro stated that the non-Catholic members of the team are being removed as quickly as possible. The second feature was that a suspicion was being cast that the Vatican might repress information damaging to the Christian faith. Allegro's account of the delay in publication of the Dead Sea Scrolls and the restriction of access to the remaining unpublished material have been recounted by his daughter Judith Ann Brown in John Marco Allegro, Maverick of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Using private letters and personal recollections, she described how Allegro attributed his exclusion from the team of editors to a Catholic monopoly and conspiracy of silence, although she could not find any evidence to support her father's suspicions. John Strugnell, a former editor-in-chief of the official publication.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.